Hi, this is Scott Garibay, and today we're going to talk about Dungeons & Dragons 5th Edition, and we're going to talk about dogs, and we're going to talk about stigma that still remains on Dungeons & Dragons. Alright, so this is interesting. What I want to do today is I want to give you an update on my Dungeons & Dragons dog named Waffles campaign, right? And how, essentially, it didn't start, and here's why. Okay. All right, and then what is my plan? What is my next plan for my Dungeons & Dragons dog game? All right, so the thing that prompted me to have a desire to run Dungeons & Dragons for a dog was the realization that dogs are now very much emerging into human space, right? So before, dogs were like, you know, chase a bone, bark at cars, that kind of thing, right? But increasingly, one of the things they're doing is they're taking the place of children. This is very real, right, for a lot of people, right? And actually the term fur baby is not even remotely obscure or unknown. Well, most people in America have heard the term fur baby multiple times at this point within the last 5 years from someone they knew, right? In addition to this, the biggest thing that just absolutely shocked me was... I am a Dungeons & Dragons commentator, and I distribute my Dungeons & Dragons commentary specifically through YouTube, right? And I have human viewers, right? But it's so shocking. There are now dogs there are dog channels on YouTube, and literally thousands, maybe hundreds of thousands of dogs every day watch their favorite channels on YouTube, right? And they determine, they are a specific community of content experiencers on YouTube. I never thought that I would be competing for viewers from channels that make content explicitly for dogs, right? Like, I just never understood that future, right? That's the future. That's the present. We live there now, right? So when I saw this, my wife walks a dog named Waffles, right? Every day, twice a day, right? And you know, we have a great relationship with the owner, and you know, we're doing him a favor, and it's working out great because our whole family just loves Waffles. He's a good friend to everybody in the family, and he's really a family friend at this point, right? So I said, you know what? I'm going to run Dungeons and Dragons for this dog because I want to expand the number of species on this planet that are blessed by Dungeons & Dragons, right? And so I got all the stuff. I made three separate ways for the dog to roll dice, right? That would be safe for the dog, and that would engage the dog. And then I, you know, figured out exactly how I was going to keep the dog engaged, shortening Dungeons & Dragons sessions, being able to tell, get a binary answer from the dog, not just a dice roll, but a yes, no, all these things. I built this system up, right? And I did all this before I talked to my wife. And I think the reason why was, I think I knew this subconsciously, but I didn't realize it until I got to the point where my entire system was created and I was ready to go tell my wife, say, hey, I've created this way for a dog to play Dungeons and Dragons safely, right? And I got to the point where it was time to talk with my wife, and then immediately, like, this dark note hit me, right? And I was like, wait a second. You know, like, because one of the things is I realized how special Waffles is to our family now, right? He's, like, really a friend to us. We really care about him, and you know. And the other thing is, you know, at first we think we started this as a favor to this friend of our family to walk his dog while he was at work, but it's really made our lives much richer, right? So this is a good situation. And I realized the moment I would talk to my wife, so I think I was like, okay, is my wife going to go along with this? This is a very unusual request. I already know the answer to that. I think the answer, I'm like 95% chance my wife would have said yes. This is, and the reason why is I would have been saying, hey, love you, dear. I'd like to run Dungeons and Dragons for a dog. And she'd be like, that's just one of 15 things that you do that nobody else in the world does. Of course, go ahead. Like, you know, like, my wife is very, you know, I'm an intense, adamant person who does things that nobody else does, right? Like, and so, and she's used to that. We've been married for 29 years. She loves me. I love her. Like, me saying to my wife, I want to run Dungeons and Dragons for a dog, would not have been a problem, right? It would have been a conversation, and, like, she would probably would have eye-rolled, but, you know, we would have got there, right? And I'm 95% chance she would have given me a yes, right? But then I realized the next step after that is me and my wife would have to go to that dog owner and say, I want to run Dungeons & Dragons for your dog, right? Now, here's the issue. The person that we would be running for, he's a really intriguing person, right? But he has no interest in Dungeons & Dragons, and I don't think he's ever played Dungeons & Dragons, right? His interests are varied, right? And he's just much more of a... He's not a genre person, right? He's really not a sci-fi person. He's not a fantasy person. He doesn't care about Star Wars, Harry Potter, Lord of the Rings, anything that I care about. And he certainly doesn't care about anything fantasy-related. He's very grounded in, like, IRL, like, you know, goes to a barber, you know, that kind of thing, right? And I realized, and I immediately, and I hadn't felt this since I was 15 years old, I felt ashamed of playing Dungeons & Dragons, right? I realized, I was like, oh my gosh, there's still a stigma on Dungeons & Dragons. And I was like, what? Why are we still here, right? Because I realized it was going to be a hard conversation, and if it went well, I could explain to this dog owner why I wanted to do this, right? And then maybe even win him over to Dungeons & Dragons, right? Maybe he would play with my group on Sundays, you know, outside of the dog game, right? But if it went south, if it went sideways, my wife was going to lose this really nice, you know, situation where she walks this dog twice a day, and our friend was going to lose Waffles, and our family could lose Waffles as a friend, right? Now, I actually think there's only about a 20% chance that I wouldn't have been able to come out the other side of that conversation successfully convincing the dog owner to let me run Dungeons & Dragons for his dog, right? But that 1 in 5 chance that our family would lose Waffles as a friend was really shocking to me. Right? Now, it's kind of like, I don't want that. I don't want that for my wife. I don't want that for the dog owner. I don't want that for Waffles. I don't want to disrupt this good thing we have, right? And I realized that I didn't want to have to explain playing Dungeons & Dragons to a person who doesn't understand Dungeons & Dragons, doesn't have any appreciation for Dungeons & Dragons, doesn't love Dungeons & Dragons, not because they're ignorant in any way or have any kind of vendetta against Dungeons & Dragons, but it's just like, to them, it's nerd stuff, right? And this guy's not a nerd. He's a non-nerd, right? He doesn't resonate at the nerd level at all, right? It's not his world, right? And it's really shocking to me because I haven't been embarrassed to play Dungeons & Dragons since I was 15 years old. I remember when I was 15, we were in junior high. I think I was in junior high, and we were moving to high school, and I had, you know, my friends were all nerds, right? But I was like, you know what? I'm physically healthy, and I think I want to be in sports, right? And so I had already been in, I want to continue as a jock. I think I want to build myself as a jock, right? And so I had this idea in my head, and I remember having this conversation with football players, with a jock crew, right? Like, there were some wrestlers, there were some football players, and there were some basketball players, right? And I had enough gravitas to have conversations with them. I didn't hang out with them. And I remember hiding the fact that I not saying, you know, somebody said, what did you do this weekend? And I was like, oh, you just threw the ball around this weekend. And I specifically did not say, yeah, me and my buddies played Dungeons and Dragons for, you know, from 4 p.m. till midnight on Saturday, right? And, you know, and and nowadays I'm very proud to tell people I play Dungeons and Dragons, but I knew that this could be disruptive, right? And honestly, if, you know, this guy does not have any problems when I come over with, you know, with my wife and see the dog and say hello to Waffles and rub his belly and throw a stick for him and take a walk in the woods. That interaction is completely fine, right? But I, you know, Dungeons and Dragons was the part that was the problem. So here's my plan. My plan right now is I don't want to disrupt this thing for my wife. I still intend to play Dungeons and Dragons with a dog. But what I'm now going to need to do is I'm going to need to find an owner who my family is not attached to and a dog my family is not attached to. So that's going to be a little bit challenging. I think I'm up for the challenge. I'm going to need to, you know, go forward carefully. I think I'm going to do this by network, right? I'm just going to ask the people I know, hey, do you know anybody who has a dog? Are they a nice person? And are they a little quirky, right? Like, you know, and so I need to find a dog owner who I don't know, who my family doesn't know the dog, who, an owner who's open to new ideas, right? So that's the next step. So I wanted to give you an update on Dungeons and Dragons 5th edition and dogs and a dog named Waffles. That's the update. Let me know if you have any questions. Thank you very much for watching. Please consider liking and subscribing, and have a wonderful millennium.